you have what's called not sold in a condition as imported. And usually what that means is it's further process. Sold prior to close. And notice the unit price at which the merchandise is sold in the greatest aggregate quantity. So this example of the question, let's see. Demonstrates. I mean, how many people like this example? I don't like this example. In fact, this whole deductive value concept, to me, it means that it's just kind of vague. But let's take a look further. How do you calculate? So, why would you use it in the first place? Well, you use it in the first place to adjust for the actual sales of the merchandise on the date of importations, 90th day or 180th day. So that means usually you have related parties. But it may also mean, how about the non-conforming shipment of product? I ordered Mickey Mouse, I got a Goofy instead. I said, no, I don't want Goofy, but the Goofy is already here. Well, to ship it back doesn't make economic sense, so what I do is I make a closeout sale. Make sense? Closeout sale. I want to get rid of it. Do I declare Goofy at the price actually paid or payable? No. There was no sale too, remember. It wasn't a sale because I reject. I said I want. Who did I say? Mickey Mouse? Or this? Well, you get the picture, right? Non-conforming. Remember, going back to our one part 141 discussion, if the product comes in, which is not the product that you asked for, then you are not liable for that product. You can say, this is not mine. And you are not liable for it. But the thing is, it must not conform to the things you actually ordered. And this regulation is in line with Uniform Commercial Code, which says that the contract is void. You have a right as a purchaser to void the contract if you asked for balls, but you got nuts, if you got a different product. Or they call it non-conforming good. And you can make a bunch of deductions too, right? That's why I call it deductive. So one way to do that is you have stressed, distressed merchandise. Or you have related transaction further processing of which we have been made, as we've seen in an example we just talked about. And notice, you can deduct commissions. In transaction value, can you deduct commissions? Mm-hmm. It's a trick question. Where's my it depends? Did you say it depends? So Kevin? No? Someone said it depends before. It depends, right? You have to ask, is it selling agent commission or the buying agent commission? Which one do you include in the transaction value? Selling. If it's selling, right? If it's buying, you don't. All right. Here, it doesn't matter. International transportation costs, well, that's obvious. And customs duties and federal taxes, that's also obvious. Yeah, you don't pay for them. Because you sold the merchandise after it was brought in, right? Yeah? Remember the DDP example? Okay. So it can be included. The bottom line is that in either situation, you always exclude customs duties and you exclude taxes. Because you can be paying duty on the product twice. If you include it in the value, which will be dutiable, it's double payment. Is double payment acceptable, double payment of duties, taxes, and fees acceptable in our society? Yeah. Customs will take your money. Okay, customs will take your money. And then you will have to, you can ask for it back. And they will give it back to you with interest. But the processing and the work it will take. If you're a licensed customs broker, I think you'll appreciate it. It will be great. You'll be just charging fees for the extra work you do. But for the importer, it's just extra work. It's cost of doing business. So that's all I wanted to say about computed value. The next topic is, I'm sorry, deductive value. So that's number three. Number four, and it can be interchangeable. So you can choose either computed value or deductive value. Is computed. Is pretty much stands for what the word says. You compute the value from the aggregate input of what's been put into the product. You include the value of the design. You go from ground up. You include the value of the plastic. I mean, you're talking about this pen. You include the value of the profit. And you include any other inputs that have been made in the process of production of the good. So, and then you declare that value. When does it make sense? Well, when there is no transaction value. If you have no transaction value, it's not sold. It makes sense if you are the designer. It usually applies to the producers, to the manufacturers. If you are the manufacturer and just making intra-company transaction from, let's say, People's Republic to the States, then you're not really selling anything. You're just transporting the merchandise and then selling it here. So what you want to do? You want to lower your value. So, but how do you lower your value? Are you going to lower it anyway? Can you ask for transaction value? You cannot, because there is no sale. So what value do you put on the invoice, on the customs invoice, or the invoice that says for customs purposes only? Well, either deductive value or the computed value. If deductive value doesn't work for you, because you don't want to stick to this 180-90-day rule requirement, then you can use computed value. But the computed value concept can be tricky, and we'll see why. So notice the usuals. This is easy, right? Fabrication and processing costs. That's a given. Assets. Well, same thing is for the transaction value. I made a mold, I include the mold, packing. Okay. Notice, no shipment charges, no freight charges. If I was to pay for the freight charges anywhere here, what would be the freight charge I would pay for, including in the cost? The shipment of the mold. The assist, to ship the assist, you include assist, the cost of the assist, the cost of the range, plus the cost to ship the range, remember? Mm-hmm. Packing. Well, that's a given. We know that packing is usually included. And that results in a computed value. This is where the devil lies. Profits and general expenses. So why is this concept so tricky, in at least from the perspective of customs? Why do not they like that?
Because
profits and general expenses. Yeah, but the problem is that again, based on my experience by going to the local corner stores, right? I bought not in this establishment, but I bought coffee somewhere else. There is a place on 67th Riga Park subway station. So I go in. They just opened the new owner. I go in and I buy coffee. He gives me the 12-ounce coffee and I say, how much? He's like, $2. Let's say $2. Okay, how much profit has he made?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. See. Is he gonna charge $12 this next person, or he can charge him $1.50? See, this is fluid. Also notice something else. What about the situation when I want to drive my competitors out of the market? So here's what I'm going to do. I'm gonna go artificially sustain a loss. Notice the profits don't have to be usually many companies, especially at the beginning, they usually file losses.
Yeah, 3 years.
I knew a company that was like 5-6 years. Constant loss. I said, I don't know how you stay in business. So this is tricky, right? So if you want to drive the competitors out of the market, which was a claim by a lot of American companies like RCA, I believe Samsung or Toshiba, in the 80s, there was a big allegation that they conspired to sell TVs at the televisions at the cost below the market, so they had to shut down their operations, and this was done intentionally, consciously, etc. So what do you do? So Samsung Electronics, they say to customers, well, we brought in these TVs, but we make no profit. We actually sell them at a loss. We just want to get foothold in the market because those RCA people, they just have those TVs everywhere. So notice, not only they can save on the customs duty, but they can also, they have customs helping them to drive out the competition out of the market. Is that problematic? Yes. So let's talk about that. So one example says a product is introduced into the States, producer accepts either no profit or low profit to offset high general expenses required to introduce it into the market. Normal. If the producer can demonstrate that there is a low profit of sales of imported merchandise because of emphasis, peculiar commercial circumstances, this is fine. The profit figures will be accepted. So if there is no profit, then no profit figures will be accepted. But you must produce valid commercial reasons. You have to have commercial reasons to justify. And valid means they have to be legal. They cannot be violate, for example, the antitrust laws of the United States. Producer have been forced to lower prices temporarily because in drop of demand. So, I don't know. I would assume that if you're gonna go buy a swimming suit right now, you would pay much less than if you were to do it 3 months ago. Because at least in the New York area, because there is a drop in demand, and this is normal. It's many people, I saw there was a, I was in a Kmart a few months ago, and there was a gentleman, not a few months, it was the winter time, I'm sorry, it was like half a year ago. The gentleman was buying life vests for swimming, for his kids, he had kids. And the cashier, she's like, oh, this is cute, and it was for sale for like a dollar. Like, are you going on vacation? And he says, yes, in 6 months, I'm going on vacation. So the point is that he was taking advantage because there is no demand, the company needs to move the inventory, and the guy was, he was just a savvy shopper. He was just a smart shopper who would like to save money and plans ahead of time his vacation needs, and there is nothing wrong with that, right? Well, if you have kids, right, you start to think this, all of a sudden, you
6 months, no big deal, it's no big change, I think.
For $1, you buy a life, there was, yeah. It's $1, it was in closer. Yeah. A life vest for, you know, the small ones for the kids, so right. they don't drown. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah. How much does Kmart make on that? Probably not much. You cannot make that much money. I'm talking about the distribution cost. I'm talking about the shipping cost.
Yeah.
And
it's on sale.
Yeah, they are looking at the shelf space.
Yeah.
They are not looking at the cost of merchandise per se.
Just like the big company.
So
how we do that?
Sorry.
All the big companies always do that.
Mm-hmm.
They get big
promotion
all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, yeah. So this brings us to the more philosophical question: Is this good for the people, right?
Yeah.
Is this good for our society?
Attracting people go to shopping over there.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Also attracting the people.
Yeah.
So you go there, get something cheap, also get something else.
Okay. So that's another way to attract, right? So is this good or not good? It's ever ending conversation because there's argument on both sides. Because the landscape of the United States has changed. We have, when Walmart, let's say, comes to town, all other businesses close down.
Yeah,
what happens to these people? Is that good for society?
No.
Thomas Jefferson would say it's not good. He was one of the founding fathers. So when I make the argument, I will say, well, that guy made narrow, not me. And nobody, when I say Thomas Jefferson, usually people are like, whoa, if Thomas Jefferson say yes, it must be true, right? So so notice, this is another thing. When you go to the customs field, as licensed customs broker, and you go and talk to customs, never speak, well, I think this is the case. No, say, well, the headquarters directive so-so states that this is what you need to do. Why are you asking me to do something different? They may have a valid reason. They say, well, this is a local practice. Because of the size of port, we're allowed to deviate. And this is fine, and I get that a lot. But oftentimes, I also get the answer like, what? Directive, can you send me the attachment so I can read it? It's like, yeah. Here we go. And then I say, I get a call back and they say, yes, sure, we agree. So, cite the authority. Who is the authority? In customs, it would be usually the headquarters, or it would be prior decisions such as rulings. It would be the court. What are the courts? Customs court. Comes on exam, you should know the customs court that has exclusive jurisdiction over most of customs matters. CIT. ITC is what? International Trade Commission. What do they do? Two things. On customs exam, customs examiners can ask you two things about the functions of ITC. What are they? Number one, maintain harmonized tariff schedule of the United States. Where do you go to get to look for ITC? You go to the to look at the HTSUS. You go to itc.gov. What's the second one? Anti-dumping.